Man crates. Awesome gifts for men in real wooden crates. Wrapped in a cocoon of duct tape. Or housed in ammo cans that are virtually indestructible. Some gifts he'll get to assemble himself. Some gifts you'll beg him to share. And some gifts are sealed inside layers of rock-solid concrete. Gifts guys love, from grilling gear to old-school video games and more. Man crates. Awesome gifts for men.
Hey there, college football fans. Welcome into College Football Daily. I'm Lena Bond, and these two studs are your college football analysts, Tom Downey and Harris Rubenstein. Guys, ready to go over the 25 recruiting classes?
Yeah, top 25. And there's been some changes since we were last on air with College Football Daily. No surprise, some of the West Coast teams got some changes. One team in particular took a big jump up.
Yeah, we got a little bit of shuffling going on. Excited to go through it. And I think people will like the rankings. I think we did a good job.
Yep, so we're going through the top 25 rankings, breaking down the winners and losers and taking a look at a few special players as we do so. But let's kick things off with the 25th best class in the 2018 recruiting ranks, and that is TCU. And one player we really want to take a look at, guys, is quarterback signee Justin Rogers. He's the highest ranked recruit under Gary Patterson ever.
And, yeah, he should come in and start right away for TCU. They obviously are losing their starting quarterback in Hill, so they need to have someone come in and make an instant impact for TCU. Look, the Big 12 for me is wide open. You know, with Baker Mayfield leaving Oklahoma, Oklahoma State losing a lot of their power as well, with Mason Rudolph heading off to the draft along with James Washington, I think TCU is a big-time chance to take a huge leap inside of the conference. And with a guy like Justin Rogers, the athleticism, the playmaking that he can bring at the quarterback position, I think would be huge for this TCU Horned Frogs team. I think along with Gary Patterson, has really proven himself to be one of the best coaches in all of college football. It's their time. I think TCU has been on an upward trend the past couple years. They had a great year last year, kind of trended downwards during the stretch. They just couldn't really handle Baker Mayfield. No one really could, but look, I think Justin Rogers is going to come in, make an instant impact. If he doesn't this year, he certainly will next year, but they got to play this guy. He might come in and already be the best guy they have on the whole team on offense.
Only reason he might not is because he is recovering from his knee surgery. If he's not healthy, then you might see Rogers have to wait until he's ready to take over in that role. If it's not Rogers, would likely be Sean Robinson.
The good news is that he has been training and working out with the TCU medical staff already, so they've been helping him recover. He's already ready to go at the facility, so hopefully he should play. I'm really excited to see him out there.
All right, TCU and Justin Rogers, someone we're looking at for the Horned Frogs. Let's take it to number 24 now, and that's the Hokies, Virginia Tech. No top 100 recruits, though, guys. So not necessarily the best recruiting class if you're a Hokies fan.
No, I mean, it's a good one, though, because you are top 25. And there are really two main ways to get in the top 25, and you do need a little bit of both. It's A, step one is getting in with a high volume number.
Yes.
Virginia Tech has that with 26. You also need some quality, two top 300 guys. Dax Hallfield is one of those. Is one of them. Trey Turner as well. This is a solid class for the Hokies. They're not going to be a top 10 class in recruiting. That's just not how they're built as a program to be. But I do trust Justin Fuente to get the most out of these guys.
All right, the Hokies coming in at number 24 in the top 2018 recruiting classes. Let's take it to 23 now. The UNC Tar Heels are checking in. They had 6 4-star recruits, and one guy we're all really excited about, William Barnes, the 53rd best prospect in the nation.
Yeah, and this recruiting class was certainly needed. North Carolina had a horrible year last year. They went 3-9 overall, but not only that, they went 1-7 inside of the ACC. So a good recruiting class for them, nice little refresher for the entire organization. I think William Barnes coming in, he might end up being a day one starter at that offensive line position, going to start at one of the tackle spots. I think Jordan Adams will come in, add something on the outside that they didn't really have last year in terms of offense. They have a couple positions that are looking good into next year, including quarterback and at least a running back, but man, they needed to shore up the offensive line. I think the defense need a little bit of work as well, but they need a big year next year because with how terrible of a year they had last year, you can't have two bad years like that in a row. The fact that they're top 25, it's huge for that program, at least going to next year's recruiting.
And it surprises me as well. UNC made a little bit of a late push by getting guys like Barnes and Adams. I think it's a big deal for the Tar Heels going forward. If they can finish in the top 25, I think that bodes well for them having a rebound year going forward each and every year.
All right, UNC checking in at 23. Let's take a look at 22 now, and this was a major riser, and that's the Nebraska Cornhuskers. They got some really, really great studs on both sides of the ball, and like you said, Tom, those players committed, that high number is what you're looking for. Nebraska had that.
Yeah, but it's also some of the quality, too. 6 4-star guys, and Nebraska, I think, in the end, was one of the biggest risers as we went from when Frost was hired to afterwards. The big name here, without a doubt, is four-star quarterback Adrian Martinez out of Fresno, California. Was committed to Tennessee, flipped to Nebraska. This is Scott Frost's guy. He will have a chance to compete for the starting job day one at Nebraska. That is a big addition. I'm also a big fan of tight end Cameron Juergens. There are a couple of nice JUCO guys sprinkled in as well. This is a fantastic class from Scott Frost. I can't wait to see what he does with a full actual year of recruiting as opposed to a truncated version.
I will say this also, last thing. They certainly outdid all the people. They're like, oh, why did Scott Frost wait until after the bowl game to move? Well, it didn't really end up mattering. Did it. He still put out an incredible class. Good for Scott Frost.
All right, Nebraska chucking in at number 22. Let's take it to 21 now, and that's where the Michigan Wolverines check in. Not the strongest recruiting class for the Michigan Wolverines. I know a lot of eyebrows are being raised with Jim Harbaugh right now.
And look, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think you need to start questioning him. Look, he's the head coach of Michigan. They cannot be number 21 coming off such a disappointing season. I get it. The quarterback position was bad. The entire offense was a work in process all year long. But, I mean, come on. In number 21, you're Michigan. You have to be better than that. Not a single five-star recruit.
Yep.
Nobody inside the top 100. The only guy they had that was close was Otis Reese, who was inside the top 100. He flipped to Georgia. So now they have a good four-star tight end, Mustafa Muhammad, who will bring some nice size and playmaking to the tight end position. But look, I think you do need to start asking questions about Jim Harbaugh. They've definitely underperformed with him as head coach so far, especially to what the expectations were. Now they come into a really poor class overall. Number 21 is not where Michigan should be. They should be in the top 10 every single year with a guy like Jim Harbaugh. This is totally baffling to me.
It's also a smaller class, just 19 guys. Michigan didn't have the scholarships to go out and throw 26, 25 scholarships like they have in the first couple years under Jim Harbaugh. And oh, by the way, this doesn't include Shea Patterson, who is the biggest transfer get by far this year. You include Shea Patterson in the recruiting class, this is easily top 10.
Yeah, sure, but at the same time, we don't know if he's going to play next year.
Doesn't matter. He still counts. He's still coming into the program.
At the same time, I think you can add him, but at the same time, take away Shea Patterson, sure, and you're still a bot. You're not even in the top 20. They need to be in the top 10 with a guy like Jim Harbaugh every year. I don't think that could be even questioned.
I'm not overly concerned about Jim Harbaugh right now. I think that they're going to be just fine going forward. 1 year outside of the top 20 isn't going to be the death knell, especially when it is a smaller class. Now, if they've got a couple straight years of non-top 100, top 20 classes, we'll see. I also still trust Jim Harbaugh to get the most out of some of the lesser scouted and lesser highly ranked players.
All right, we have a reaction poll. We're talking about it here, but we want to know your thoughts. Are you questioning Jim Harbaugh if you're Michigan or if you're a Michigan fan? Go ahead and throw up your reactions. Harris, it sounds like you're questioning him, but Tom, not so much.
No, I'm not going to question right now. Now, if Michigan has another bad year and they win like 8 games and it's going to be another tough year in the Big Ten, maybe we can have this discussion. But I think it's a little unfair to say, oh, Jim Harbaugh, you know, why haven't you won the Big Ten yet? Like, I think the first 2 years of the Harbaugh year were really good. This year was supposed to be a down year. Like, we mentioned that leading up to, like, oh, you know what, Michigan? This is not going to be their year. Next year might be their year. Then this year wasn't great, and everyone's like, it's over. Michigan needs to fire Harbaugh. I think it's a little bit reactionary.
I'm going to put this under wait until after the season. Look, if they have a bad year, the bad year last year, plus a bad recruiting class, plus another bad season, then you have to ask questions. But again, this recruiting class for number 21, you can't just brush it aside and be like, oh, it's this and that. It's still number 21. You're Michigan. You're Jim Harbaugh. The expectations for you are, there's a certain bar that you have to hit if you're Jim Harbaugh, the head coach of Michigan. And I'm sorry, being number 21 does not hit those expectations, and it's certainly way below the bar that they've certainly set for themselves.
All right, before we get into the top 20, here's a quick recap of who fills up the bottom of the top 25. TCU, Virginia Tech, UNC, Nebraska, and Michigan. Before we dive into that top 20, we just want to say we are presented by Man Crates. Valentine's Day is tomorrow. May have missed your opportunity to get a Man Crate for that, but don't worry. They have all sorts of things for all types of the year, for birthdays, anniversaries, you name it. Tom, I know you're a really big fan of that meat bouquet.
Yeah,
they have
it's delicious. The salami is incredible. The gator jerky, you can get jerky grams.
So good.
The gator jerky is really good. You have to try that one.
All right, get one at mancrates.com. But let's get into that top 20. And coming in at number 20, we have the Tennessee Vols. And Tom, I want to toss it to you. 7th ranked class in the SEC. Are you a little disappointed?
Yes and no. First off, we always know that there are a lot of really highly ranked SEC teams.
Yes, of course.
First off, you can look at it. Ooh, they're 7th in their conference, but these recruiting rankings always tend to skew towards the SEC. Tennessee at 7, that's fine. I think maybe what concerns me the most is, what's their biggest problem right now, Harris? It's the lack of a good quarterback, right? Mm-hmm. I don't think the only quarterback that they brought in, three-star quarterback JT Shrout, is going to be the answer. Now, I do like JT Peterson, a very talented outside linebacker. He was their biggest guy, but I just it's a good class. I don't want to undersell any that it's not a good class, but I don't know if it's the class that's going to get Tennessee back.
I don't think so, but you know, for the year that Tennessee had, being able to be in the top 25, good for them after everything that happened this year with the head coaches and everything going back and forth and Shiano. The fact that they were able to keep J.J. Peterson on this team is actually, I think, going to end up being massive for them.
Look,
he's
a
good player.
They lost a lot of guys in the season. Cade Mays, the biggest of them, a five-star offensive tackle from Knoxville, Tennessee, left Tennessee after all, everything that went down with that with Coach Butch Jones and just all that mess that they had this year because they were terrible on the field. And it paid. Or Tennessee paid the price. That's why they're 20 and not like 15 or 10 had Butch Jones had a good year and had he not been fired because of poor performance on the field.
All right, the Vols checking in at number 20. Let's take it to another SEC school, and that's South Carolina. They come in at 19. They were the sixth best SEC class, and one person we're quite excited about is Josh Van, friend of the program,
Harris. Friend of the program, Josh Van. I think this is a great class for South Carolina. Look, with Will Muschamp at head coach, they have to continue to grow the program, and a way to grow the program is to allow to just these small kind of recruiting classes that are deep with a lot of talent in them can really help your program in the future. Obviously, they don't have that big top number one guy to really build the program around, but this is how you get from one place to another. You have to start small and grow through the SEC. They've had a couple of down years, but they won a bowl game this year against Michigan. I'm happy with this. I think this is a good class for South Carolina. I think Josh Van is going to be a really good player for them to have on the outside, along with their quarterback, Jake Bentley. I'm really excited for the South Carolina team. I think they're going places. This is a good upward trend for the Gamecocks.
All right, let's take it to number 18 now, and this is the first time we're seeing a Pac-12 school on this list, and that's the UCLA Bruins. It's their first year under Chip Kelly. Of course, he didn't get a full year on the recruiting trail, but hey, not a bad ranking with that being said.
Volume, 28 commits led by Dorian Thompson-Robinson. This is, again, we talk about how volume and quality and first quantity matters. This is a quantity class, 28 guys, a lot of guys that in particular – Chip Kelly won it, and I think it starts and ends really with quarterback Dorian Thompson-Robinson. This is supposed to be the guy for UCLA going forward, and I do want to see what he ends up doing for UCLA. I don't think he's ready to play quite yet. Didn't actually play a whole lot in high school because he was stuck behind a guy named Tate Martell who was now at Ohio State. But this is an interesting class put together by UCLA. The volume's there. The quality isn't quite as good as I think you'll expect to see it from Chip Kelly going forward, but for kind of a truncated recruiting season, it's a pretty solid job by Chip Kelly, and I think it's only going to get better for the Bruins.
All right, Bruins checking in at number 18. Let's look at the 17 now, and that's the Texas A&M. Now, pretty good recruit volume-wise, as Tom would say, 23. They did get 13 four-star recruits. No five stars, but 13 is definitely a good stat right there.
Yeah, and I think for Texas A&M, you know, with a lot of the rumblings going around about who's going to be their head coach, they did end up with Jimbo Fisher, and I think this is a good class for them going into the Jimbo Fisher era. I think next year is going to be the real test for what is he going to do with the full offseason.
Right.
It was kind of cut in half, but overall, getting number 17 for Texas A&M, if you look at them for the past 2 to 3 years before this is about where they were. They did peak at number 11 back in 2011. They had that crazy class that I believe came out at number 4 and number 5 back in 2014. So with Texas A&M being here in 2018, I think it's fine. Let's give Jimbo Fisher one full offseason, really see what he could do. Like we'll talk about later in the show, Texas actually got most of the big guys inside of Texas. Mm-hmm. I would be very surprised if they were able to do that in back-to-back years, especially now with Jimbo Fisher in state.
A solid start here for A&M, getting in 13 four-star guys. They pulled away guys like Bobby Brown, who was committed to Alabama.
Yep.
That was a big get for Jimbo Fisher. They've got guys like Jalen Preston and Leon Neal, both of whom are top 100 guys. It's a very solid start for the Aggies. They did kind of close pretty well. I think it's a promising sign for Jimbo Fisher, who, as we'll discuss later, didn't really leave FSU in that creative shape.
No, he did not.
All right, let's take it to another Pac-12 school. It's coming in at number 16, and that's my Oregon Ducks. Now, they started in the recruiting rankings at 14. They were at 15. They even flirted with top 10 for a little bit, eventually settled at 16. No five-star recruits, but an overall solid recruiting class, taking into consideration they did lose Willie Taggart.
Yeah, Oregon, Lana, since you are in Oregon alumni, what do you make of this recruiting class overall? Are you happy with it, or are you a little bit disappointed that it could have been better had Taggart stuck around?
Of course, you're gonna that what if is always gonna hurt you, right? What would this recruiting class been with Willie Taggart? I think that's one of the reasons he got the Oregon job in the first place, is just all the ties he had with recruiting. With that being said, Mario Cristobal, I'm not disappointed in this class. I think it could have been a lot worse. No five stars, that's always hurts. But one person I'm really excited about is Penway Sewell. He's an offensive guard, not a person the Ducks really expected to get. A lot of people thought that he was either gonna go to USC or Utah. He decided to be a Duck, so I'm excited to see what he's able to do and beef up that offensive line to protect Justin Herbert and other perhaps Tyler Shuck moving forward. But overall,
friend of the show, Tyler Shuck.
But yeah, pretty solid class overall for my Oregon Ducks. And there you go. Let's go ahead and recap 20 through 16. We got the Vols, we got South Carolina, UCLA, Texas A&M, and Oregon. All right, guys, let's keep it moving in our top 2018 recruiting classes. Let's take it to 15, and that's where the LSU Tigers check in. They had 22 players commit overall. They did have a five-star and two recruits in the top 100.
So I'm actually going to go on a limb and say I think this LSU class was actually pretty big disappointment. If you look back at the past couple years with LSU, they've consistently ranked in the top 10, including in two top five finishes in the past 4 years. Now they're at number 15. I think this is more of Georgia kind of taking away a lot of players from the top half of the SEC. But look, getting Terrace Marshall is really, really good for this team. He's the big guy. He's the big name on this offense. But they need someone to build around that's not him. They lost Darius Geis this year to the draft. They lost Leonard Fournette last year. Hopefully, Terrace Marshall can bring that star power that they've been looking for on the wide receiver position ever since they've lost the guys like Odell Beckham Jr. and Jarvis Landry. He's the top-ranked player in Louisiana, so being able to keep him in-state and have him go to LSU is absolutely massive. But at the same time, you have to look at who's going to be throwing him the ball. Tom, I think you and I both can agree that Danny Etling is not the guy of the future for LSU. He's not that good. He's also gone. Exactly. So I don't think this LSU team overall is going to have a great year next year. I think Ed Orgeron's one of his first classes. I think it's a disappointment. Being number 15 for LSU, especially what they've been able to do the past 5 years, ranking at least in the top five, top 10, if not the top five, being a number 15 again, it's low for them.
I think not getting Patrick Surtain Jr. definitely hurt this class,
agreed,
too. I almost think that was something that they were banking on, and he obviously chose.
I mean, look, here's the big thing with LSU. This is still a top 15 class. It's by no means bad, but it's not what we expect out of LSU, and I look for one particular reason. They didn't recruit the state of Louisiana as well as they have in the past. Now, yes, they kept Terrace Marshall. Yes, they kept Kelvin Joseph, the top two guys in the state of Louisiana, and they also kept Jamar Chase. They didn't keep Justin Rogers. He went to TCU. Mm-hmm. That would have filled the need at quarterback, you would think, because they desperately need one. They lost Devonta Johnson, another receiver, so you know they only take so many, to Mississippi State. They lost two guys to Kansas, and Anthony Williams and Corion Harris.
You never want to lose guys to Kansas.
And they lost Lawrence Keys to Notre Dame. So this is not the same keeping the top level of top Louisiana prospects in state. And I look at missing out on Justin Rogers. If they had Justin Rogers, I think we evaluate this class differently because, they've got their quarterback. I don't know who their quarterback is going to be long term. They don't have one right now.
Justin Rogers plus Terrace Marshall sounds like a pretty good way to rebuild an offense, don't you think?
It does indeed. And of course, they both went to the same high school, Parkway in Louisiana.
Oh,
so they could have kept the duo together. They chose not to.
Yep.
All right, let's stick with the SEC as we move on to number 14. That's the Florida Gators. Tom, how did Dan Mullen do?
It could have been better, and I look at a couple different guys that they missed out on. We'll start with the positive here for Florida. They kept Emory Jones,
yes,
and they went out and got Emory Jones. So that was a big addition for them. He's their top recruit. He's a four-star quarterback. Now, he did drop down when the services updated their rankings. He was in the top 50, ended up only being number 85 overall, but he's a dual-threat quarterback. We saw Felipe Franks not look that good.
No.
The big thing for Florida is that they're hoping, hey, Emory Jones, can he come in and be our Dak Prescott to learn to spar one of Dan Mullen's former QBs?
And they also got four-star wide receiver Jacob Copeland to go with them.
Yeah, who I wanted to mention. I think that getting both of them, like what we were talking about with Justin Rogers and Terrace Marshall, if you can have two top-end guys in one recruiting class come in and be the faces of your next offense, already you're winning. Obviously, you know, you never really know what's going to happen with recruits, but it's always good to have those two guys that you can build around, have them kind of learn an early repertoire together. I think Jacob Copeland should actually make a pretty decent impact in his freshman year. We'll see if Emory Jones ends up starting, but at the same time, it's going to be good for them to come into the same freshman class and be able to get that time together. It should help in the future.
They also brought in Justin Watkins, a top 100 receiver, and Kyle Pitts, who's a four-star tight end. In theory, that should help upgrade Florida, but One of their only other big additions on national signing day, at least the most recent one, was Andrew Chatfield, which was a good get. He's a four-star defensive end, but he's only 213 overall. Florida missed out on some high-profile guys, which we'll discuss later on in the show because they went to programs that ranked higher in the top 25. But I think it's an example of, oh, what could have been Florida. By no means bad, but not quite what I think Mullen and the Gators had hoped for.
We've criticized some other coaches that have come in that are new, that haven't had great coaching, haven't had great recruiting classes. Of all the new coaches that have come in this year, Florida actually ranks the highest of the team with a new coach. So, not a terrible
look. No, they don't.
Florida State.
Florida State. Right.
Willie Taggart got in there. Close, though. I see where you're getting with that. But let's go ahead and check in at number 13 now. It's another Pac-12 school in the Washington Huskies. I wouldn't necessarily say they had any sexy recruits, but a deep class nonetheless.
This is a really interesting class, Tom, because two of their top recruits are two quarterbacks, and now they have Jacob Eason coming in as well. So you can never have too many quarterbacks in college football. It's kind of different in the NFL. If you have two quarterbacks, you have zero, whatever. But
I still think if you're actively playing two quarterbacks, it's different to recruit a young one.
So I think that having Kolson Yankoff come in and Jacob Sermon is really good for the program, along with Jacob Eason. But
all the quarterbacks are now in Washington.
Exactly. They have all of them, but at the same time, that's kind of a problem because most of the quality of their class is coming from those two top quarterbacks. Kolson Yankoff is the highest-ranked recruit to ever come out of the state of Idaho. Good for you, Idaho.
But
you got to one of the big time.
Have there ever been recruits out of Idaho in the past?
Asking the real question.
Like, can we confirm that?
Why hate on Idaho?
Because it's Idaho.
There aren't a lot
of great recruits coming out of Idaho.
I think another guy to also look at in this class is Marcus Spiker. Look, they're losing Dante Pettis, who I'm not saying that Marcus Spiker is going to come in and be the return guy, but Dante Pettis was one of the top receiving options that they've had for his entire collegiate career. They need someone who's similar to him to come in and fill that void. I think he should do a decent job at that.
I'm excited to see what this Washington class ends up being, and it doesn't count Jacob Eason, which if it does, again, it's easily top 10.
Yeah.
All right, let's keep it rolling. Check it in at number 12. We have the Auburn Tigers. 24 players committed overall, and I think it's easy to say that this class is very offense-heavy, guys.
Well, I think they're going to need some more offense, especially given who they lost up front, especially at halfback. And I think in the end, this class is going to be very much focused on four-star athlete Joey Gatewood. Well, he's not going to be an athlete for Auburn, and Gus Malzahn has kind of made this pretty clear. He believes that Joey Gatewood is going to be a quarterback, and when it comes to Gatewood, he comped him to Cam Newton, which when you do that as the head coach of Auburn, I think you're setting up wildly high expectations, and I don't know if that's exactly fair to Gatewood. He definitely needs some time and some development as a quarterback, but he'll get to learn behind Jarrett Stidham. He is kind of the starting and ending point of this class. Top 50 overall, the number one athlete. He has the size to be a Cam Newton type player. We'll see if he has the actual accuracy.
I also think another guy you want to look at is wide receiver Matthew Hill. He's going to come in. Again, like what we were talking about with some of the other young wide receiver quarterback combos, they'll end up working together a lot. Quindarius Monday, a
great name.
I was going to say possibly the best name that we have in this class.
Hard to say.
For Auburn.
Really. I think that this is a good overall class for Auburn. Good couple of players that they could bring in. Another good option in Joey Gatewood to build around on offense. Just solid all around for them.
Auburn was in the top 10 for a good portion of the pre-end of signing day, and then some of the teams had made leaps ahead of them, and we'll discuss some of those teams coming up in a little bit.
All right, let's take it to a team we were just talking about, the Florida State Seminoles. They checked in at number 11 with a brand new head coach, guys. That's impressive.
But Lena, are you jealous?
Do we really have to talk about this?
I'm trying
to get over it. But good for Willie Taggart. Good for Willie Taggart. We talked about it endless times on College Football Daily. It was his dream school. Good for him. Glad he took the job. Let bygones be bygones.
And also, if you kind of look back at some of our earlier College Football Daily shows, we actually talked a good amount about how bad Florida State had been looking in the recruiting game so far. And here they end up at number 11. Has a lot to do with Asante Samuel Jr.
Yes,
you are that old. Jaden Woodby's coming in as well, that they stole him. So, look, it's a good class overall for Florida State. Being able to steal Jaden Woodby away was a huge coup for them from Ohio State.
Yes.
I think it's going to end up being maybe the guy that they slot in day one to replace someone like a Derwin James, who they're losing to the draft. So Woodby's going to come in, be a really good option for them at the back end of the defense. Asante Samuel Jr. will help in the cornerback slot as well. This is a really good class for Florida State, considering everything that happened. It almost kind of gets you really scared for what they could do next year with the full offseason Willie Taggart.
I am really excited to see that, and I think that getting Woodby was – really, I think, one of the better steals of the early signing day period for Florida State to go in, get Obi and get him to enroll early, I think, is a big boost. I think that's maybe a big reason why you could see him play early in his college football career at FSU. The DBs in general, you see, would be Samuel and Lighten up there. Maybe FSU can kind of make another run at being DBU.
Yeah.
All right, before we break into the top 10, we are presented by Man Crates. Awesome gifts for guys. And what I think a lot of guys love about Man Crates is just the crowbar and the wooden crate that it comes in. Just, it's all about the details, right?
Testosterone right there.
Yeah, yes. Testosterone in a box, as James Yoder would say. All right, before we break into the top 10, I'm Lena Bond. These are your college football analysts, Tom Downey and Harris Rubenstein. Let's go ahead and kick it now to number 10, and that's Notre Dame. And they kind of jumped around the rankings all throughout National Signing Day, ended up at number 10, and I really think it's because they had 27 players commit to play for them.
We've mentioned a couple times, volume matters, and Notre Dame doesn't have the five-star guys, but if you're most college football programs, I think there are some a few exceptions. You're going to say, ooh, top 10 class, done, sold, sign me up. I'll take that on a heartbeat. And that's what Notre Dame did this year under Brian Kelly. It starts with four-star cornerback Houston Griffith, friend of the show. Mm-hmm. Again, he's from IMG Academy, 11th ranked at his position. I'm excited to see him play. Notre Dame, in college football, you always do need more corners.
Yes.
You'll see Griffith at least have a chance to make some early playing time, make some early impact. He's number 70 overall. I'm excited to see what he can bring. He enrolled early. That gives him a shot to play early. Also, keep an eye on four-star quarterback Phil Jurkovich. Look, they needed another quarterback. They've lost some guys in the past with transfers. Brandon Wimbush is not going to be there forever. I'm excited to see what Jurkovich brings. But it's not a great quality class, but the quantity is why Notre Dame is in the top 10 as opposed to a Florida State with 21 guys. So that's where the difference lies.
Jurkovich is a really good get for them, the number two player in the entire state of Pennsylvania. And for those who don't know this, the number one and three guy both ended up going to Penn State. A lot of people thought that Jurkovich could maybe go to Ohio State, so them being able to bring him in is really good. He should match up to about when Brandon Wimbush is leaving. So hopefully maybe at the end of this year or to start of next year, you'll start to see him get a lot of playing time. I think that's maybe the sneaky best prospect that they've gotten in this class.
And maybe their biggest, the most recent National Signing Day addition was a guy named Lawrence Keys III. They beat out teams like LSU and Texas to land him. Mm-hmm.
All right, the Fighting Irish checking in at number 10. At number 9, we have the Oklahoma Sooners, a team that was red hot on offense last year, but they had a lot of defensive pickups in this 2018 recruiting class.
And definitely needed. Boy, was it needed. It's probably what didn't give them a chance in the national championship. But I think that bringing in Bray Walker as well to replace Orlando Brown is heading to the draft is huge. He's going to be a day one starter, five-star offensive tackle. He's going to be maybe one of the best players in this entire class. I'm a big believer in him. But look, we saw what Texas was able to do, keeping everyone in the state of Texas and building what should be a very, very good young defense. Well, Oklahoma has players to match, bringing in four-star Ronnie Perkins, bringing in four-star Brennan Radley Hill. So I think that bringing in a lot of these defensive guys, it's going to be really good for them. It's going to be really good for the Big 12 as well. I like to call them the Pillow Fight Conference because they just throw a bunch of offense, just throw the ball millions of times, whatever. Everyone's going to score 50 points a game. This is really good for the Oklahoma program in general. I like what Lincoln Riley is trying to do with this. And again, having that five-star recruit to build around, the little jewel of your crown and Bray Walker, makes this class even better. 9, I think, is a little bit low than what I would have expected for them coming off a season like this. But look, you can never complain about a top 10 class and a five-star recruit.
I mean, look, back to Bray Walker. He's huge. He's listed at 6'7", 330 pounds, which is program weight. So, see if it's accurate.
Tom, at 18 years old being that big, how is that even possible?
To be fair, he does look really big. And again, he's not always playing against the same level of competition, even in some of these camps. But he didn't enroll early, so we'll see if that takes him a little bit of time to acclimate to the college game, if having that extra couple months would have helped him be a starter from day one. We'll see. I do like a lot of what Bray Walker brings, and he does remind me of Orlando Brown. He's big and tall, and he's got the same size and potentially strength that Brown has as well. But overall, 22 recruits, I think that keeps Oklahoma down a little bit lower than some of the other programs that have more quantity. The quality is still very solid, though, for the Sooners.
All right, moving on in our top 2018 recruiting classes, we have the Miami Hurricanes, the number 2 class in the ACC. And guys, a lot of people want to don that turnover chain for the Hurricanes.
And I think there are some notable defensive guys, namely Al Blades Jr. And Nesta Silvera. Those are the two big-name defensive players for the Hurricanes. But there are some notable offensive guys that they brought in this year. Tight end Brevin Jordan, I think, could be really good. The U has produced some very good tight ends. But their number one guy is Lorenzo Lingard, number 25 overall, the five-star running back. With Mark Walton gone to the NFL, Lingard will at least have a chance to make an early impact and get some early reps for the Hurricanes. He's a little bit bigger than you see most halfbacks. He's pretty fast, though, as well. I'm excited to see what he can do for the Hurricanes. And I think Miami, with the way things ended last year, I think they're open and willing to letting some of these impact freshmen make an impact right away and come in and not have to sit and wait like some other programs often have their freshmen do. I don't think the depth is quite there yet for Miami.
Agreed, but I still give this class an A for Miami.
Oh, yeah.
Coming off the season, they had, again, we talked about this with South Carolina, it's all about that upward trend, gaining that momentum, going into season after season after season. This is momentum. Getting the 8th-ranked class is huge for them. Lorenzo Lingard is going to be a huge national pull in terms of being able to get the higher star guys onto this team. And like you said, the defensive additions are definitely going to help. They're losing a couple big-time defenders to the draft, but I love this class for Miami.
Two names not on this list. One serious, one kind of not serious. Four-star quarterback Jaren Williams, number 77 overall. Mm-hmm. It's not going to be right away. I don't think the Hurricanes are going to try and have him be the next quarterback, but he could be the quarterback long-term going forward. We use franchise in the NFL. He could be that type of quarterback for the Hurricanes that they haven't really had. It was supposed to be Brad Kaya. He was never really that guy, though, for the Hurricanes.
No, never there.
And then they got 3-star kicker Bubba Bax, which I think is a great name.
Bubba Bax?
Bubba Bax is his name.
Wow.
B-A-X-A.
Is that not the most Miami kicker name you've ever heard? Bubba Bax?
I think it's great, and we'll see if he ends up being any good. I don't know if it's actually Miami, but it's a great name anyway.
That's awesome.
All right, let's take it to number 7 now. And this is the team you might be surprised to see so low in the recruiting class rankings, and that's the Alabama Crimson Tide, guys.
Boy, are they happy that Patrick Surtain Jr. took them, because if he didn't, we'd be having a much, much different conversation. But getting 2 5-star guys in Ayabi Ainoma and Patrick Surtain kind of saves this entire class for Alabama. Look, it doesn't have what they're usually looking for. Obviously, Alabama for the past 7 years has been number one. And I think we talked a lot about how the overall quantity of classes has really been vaulting up a lot of these teams. And look, only 19 committed players for Alabama is definitely what's dropping them down the list. I think you can also compare it to a class like Clemson, who again doesn't have that overall amount. They only have 17 recruits. But look, Alabama getting 19, 2 5-star guys, and Patrick Surtain Jr. is going to be an incredible force for that Alabama team. They haven't had a corner like him come in a very long time. He's going to be an absolute stud. And look, they need someone to replace Micah Fitzpatrick, who's going to the draft. Patrick Surtain Jr. is a little bit more of an outside corner than what Micah Fitzpatrick's been. Obviously, kind of more of that safety plus corner plus wherever else you want to play him on defense. But Patrick Surtain Jr. is that huge star that they've been looking for at cornerback. He's going to be a really, really good addition for them. And again, this can't overstate how good Ayabi Ainoma is going to be for them as well. Coming from Maryland, he's going to be a really, really solid player for them as well. Coming off the end, they are losing a lot of defensive linemen to the draft.
They do that every year.
Yeah, exactly. So here comes in the next rotation, another 5-star guy, the number 1 weak side defensive end and the number 4 player overall. He's their top recruit this year. He's going to be fantastic, but I think Patrick Surtain Jr. is going to have a better freshman season. I think Ainoma will end up having a better career.
Yeah, Patrick Surtain did say that he plans on starting his freshman season.
Of course he says that. You know, it's funny with Alabama. It was kind of a good and bad. It was very much a mixed bag on the final national signing day. They did land Surtain. They also land Jalen Waddle, a top 40 receiver. But they also lost 4-star defense tackle Bobby Brown. He flipped to A&M, and they also lost linebacker Quay Walker to Georgia. So Alabama at one point was in the top 5, and then they kind of slid back down if they lost some guys. Some other teams made some big additions.
All right, I have a question for you guys. Do you think the coaching turnover that Alabama has faced this offseason hurt them with recruiting? They lost a lot of guys, 4 coaches this offseason, to be exact.
It certainly didn't help. I'll put it that way. Like, there's no way to say that it had to hurt, because when you lose that many coaches, including your offensive coordinator and your defensive coordinator, I know they still have Nick Saban, but it's going to leave a mark. It's going to make an impact, especially when those guys are going to other schools, especially Jeremy Pruitt going to a school inside of your conference. So it does hurt, but I don't think it hurts as much as people are trying to point out. They still have the granddaddy of recruiting in Nick Saban, so it can really only make that much of an impact. And if it hurt that much, how are they still able to get Patrick Surtain Jr.?
Look, I think with Alabama, yes, it's not the class we're expected to seeing from Alabama. Like, they've been number one for several years in a row. Now they're 7. It's like, oh, man, it's a bad year. They only took 19 guys. This class wasn't as large as some of the other Alabama ones in the past. And this, look, they don't really get a top 100 guy, because they did get 4-star JUCO Savion Smith, who was a 5-star when he came out and signed with LSU, went to JUCO and is now at Alabama. That's a big get there. They also, by the way, they get but don't count here, top 100 defensive end from last year, Drez Parks, who gray-shirted. Because Alabama's class last year was so good, they took a top 100 recruit and had him gray shirt and sit out a year. Now he gets to play.
One last thing I do want to point out before we move on from Alabama. No quarterbacks in this 2018 class.
They don't need one because it's Tua time,
baby. Good point.
It's Tua time.
It's a good point.
All right, fair enough. Could it hurt them in the future, though?
Look, depth always matters. Maybe, so yes. And then they had the one kid who ended up going to Princeton instead because, hey, academics matter.
Yep.
And rightfully so. So, look, it's a fine class for Alabama. I know it's not the one that everyone is so expected to seeing the Crimson Tide put together. But 98% of the teams in the nation would be like, oh, top seven class? Done. Sign me up.
And, like, two is probably going to start for at least the next two seasons, you hope. So, if they bring in a top-ranked quarterback next year, then you're not really missing out too much. Tua is the starter going forward. I think they'll be fine.
Okay. All right. Let's take it now to number six. And at number six are the Clemson Tigers, the number one class in the ACC. Quantity might not be there, Tom, but I think quality is where the Clemson Tigers nailed it.
Quality-wise, it's a top five class. And they've got so many five-star guys, five of them in total. KJ Henry, Jackson Carmen didn't make the list here. Two guys that did. And we'll start with defensive end Xavier Thomas. And I think with Thomas in particular, I know that he's only number three in the nation and that the quarterbacks are ahead of him. I think Thomas, though, might be the guy that makes the biggest impact right away because you can find a role from him. It's a little tough to input a quarterback right away. Like, they need time to acclimate. For defensive end, even if it's just a third down role, it's, hey, Thomas, go get the quarterback on this third and 12. And it's the rich get richer again because this Clemson defensive line is absolutely loaded. Mm-hmm. And now they get Xavier Thomas. Now they get KJ Henry. It's going to be even better next year. I think when we look back at this class 5 years from now, we're going to say, oh, this Clemson defensive line and this year's from what they had this year with the guys coming back and the guys they added, they could have like five first-round picks. That's insane.
It's also huge of the guys coming back. You're telling me that Christian Wilkins and Austin Bryant aren't going to teach these guys everything they know? Absolutely. They love
Clelin Ferrell.
Clelin Ferrell as well. They're definitely going to help these guys come along, which is so huge. Might be one of the reasons they came back as well. Who knows? You'll never actually know. But I think that also, you know, we haven't even talked about Trevor Lawrence, the number one recruit in this entire class.
Sunshine Trevor Lawrence because of his
hair. Look at
that hair. Yeah, well, you can't see it here. You'll see it here in a minute here because it's tough to tell with his helmet on. Lawrence, I like his hype reel because it's a lot of him just kind of running around playing backyard football. Oh, offensive line got blown up. I'm going to run backward and throw it like I'm Russell Wilson, Aaron Rodgers, Brett Favre, whatever. Mm-hmm. And I am curious what Clemson ends up doing at the quarterback position. Mm-hmm. Kelly Bryant is a nice mobile quarterback. I don't think he's a great thrower of the football. I've said that really since day one.
Agreed.
And I think that kind of was seen in the college football playoff. And I wouldn't be opposed to Clemson saying, hey, you know what? Let's give Hunter Johnson, the five-star quarterback from last year, or even Sunshine Trevor Lawrence here, a shot next year. I don't know if Clemson's going to actually do that, but I think Lawrence has the ability to be the quarterback that plays right away. Look, he is not Deshaun Watson. Nobody is, but Watson wasn't the number one overall recruit like Trevor is.
No, he wasn't.
Just saying.
And I will say this. I think we can now officially never be surprised again when we see Clemson have a top 10 class. I think the surprise is officially over.
Clemson does not rebuild. They reload now under Dabo Sweeney. They are going to be a constant threat in it for the college football playoff. They also got four-star wide receiver Justin Ross on signing day because, well, Clemson wasn't done with just a solid top 15 of kids.
And also Darion Kendrick, the other five-star wide receiver they got. We could keep going all day with these people that they got.
Clemson has an absolutely ridiculous class. And before we break into the top five, let's go ahead and recap what we have in the top 25. TCU, Virginia Tech, North Carolina, Nebraska, and Michigan checking in at number 21. At 20, we have the Vols followed by South Carolina, UCLA, Texas A&M, and my Oregon Ducks. At 15, we have LSU Tigers followed by Florida, Washington, Auburn, and Florida State. And then we have Notre Dame, Oklahoma, Miami, Alabama, and Clemson. All right, guys, let's go ahead and take it now to the top five, and we're going to take it to Penn State. Now, they are number two in the Big Ten and had a pretty deep and high-quality class.
Yeah, and I love this class for them, and I think it begins and ends with Micah Parsons. That dude is going to be an absolute monster for them on the defensive side of the ball. I think over the past couple years, you see Penn State. They've been obviously a very offensive-focused team with Trace McSorley and all the wide receivers that have come through, obviously with Saquon Barkley, but now a little bit more defensive. Here comes Micah Parsons, maybe just the best defensive player in this class after Xavier Thomas. Depends on who you like more and what style at the end you like, but Look, Micah Parsons is going to be an absolute monster inside of the Big Ten. He's a perfect fit coming in. I imagine he'll kind of be a more Rashawn Gary-style player, that he's going to get doubled on every single play, because if you don't, he's just going to absolutely eat you alive. It's also great for the Penn State program. Top-ranked guy coming out of Pennsylvania, able to keep him in-state. The number three guy coming out of Pennsylvania, able to keep him inside of Penn State. So I think just a great class overall for them. They also get Justin Shorter. So we've talked a lot about how different classes are coming from different states. Penn State in the past has always tried to dominate the state of New Jersey because, for whatever reason, Rutgers doesn't know how to run a football program. So they were able to get Justin Shorter, the number one guy out of the state of New Jersey. A huge get for them. They have to be able to lock down there and also lock down the state of Maryland. I think Ricky Slade coming in will also be a really good replacement for Saquon Barkley, an all-purpose back. This is a fantastic class for James Franklin. Has quality, has quantity, has five-star guys all over the place, and has good depth as well. Perfect class for them coming off another good season.
I think this Penn State class gets a little overlooked when we talk about some of the teams that had the best recruiting classes. It's a top five class for Penn State. Again, that's a fantastic job that James Franklin done. I think it's overlooked because their three biggest guys, Parsons, Shorter, and Slade, look, they all committed and signed back in the early signing day period, so the hype around, ooh, are they going to land this other guy, really wasn't there for like a Patrick Surtain. They weren't in the mix for those guys. They had most of their class locked up and done before we got to the actual signing day period. Now, Rashid Walker did commit. He's a top 70 offensive tackle out of Maryland. But I think this is a great class for Penn State, and they might not be on our winners list later on, but I don't want to discount what Penn State has done because they had a fantastic class this year. Mm-hmm.
All right, let's take it to number four, and this is the highest-ranked Pac-12 team, and that's the USC Trojans. Weren't looking super hot in the early signing day period, but boy, oh boy, did they finish strong.
When you factor in only what a team did on the actual national signing day, USC might be the biggest winner of all. Mm-hmm. USC, what they did really from the opening of the early signing day period until now was absolutely incredible. A lot of guys we'll discuss here. We'll start with five-star wide receiver Amon-Ra St. Brown. Great name. His brother was Equanimeous St. Brown. Easier to say, just EQ St. Brown. He went to Notre Dame. A big addition here for USC. Number 11 overall, the number two wide receiver. They beat Notre Dame. Now, I think the younger St. Brown, first off, great catch there. I think the younger St. Brown didn't want to follow his brother's path per se, so he stays in state. He goes to USC. With guys like Deonte Burnett leaving, you could see St. Brown make a bit of an early impact. I think he's got the athletic ability to be that guy early on. Not the only guy, though, that USC went out and pulled in. JT Daniels, the five-star quarterback, same high school as St. Brown. He reclassified. Now, what that means is JT Daniels wasn't supposed to graduate high school until next year and was supposed to be a class of 2019 recruit. He said, you know what? I'm going to graduate early. I'm going to reclassify into this year's class and enroll when he's supposed to be a high school senior. Mm-hmm. Now he enrolls early, reclassified in the class of 2018, was a very highly ranked recruit that this happened in the early signing day period. With USC losing Sam Darnold, I think Daniels saw his opportunity to say, hey, I'm going to enroll early and try and win this starting job right away, which is kind of insane to think about.
I also think with this USC class, you know, obviously losing Burnett, they're losing Ronald Jones, they're losing Darnold as well. You have to go back to what they did last year also. Mm-hmm. They got Stephen Carr, one of the top recruits in the entire country, the number three overall running back. They also got Joseph Lewis, one of the best wide receivers in the country as well. Two five-star guys. Now they bring in another five-star wide receiver in Amon-Ra St. Brown. Now they have their quarterback, JT Daniels. That is one heck of a young offense, if you ask me. They're going to have youth all over the offense next year. Offensive line included, they had Austin Jackson last year, the number one guy in the state of California, at least on the offensive line. So, look, they're really rebuilding that offense, and they needed to. It got a little stagnant last year when Sam Darnold continued to turn the ball over. I think this is a new era for USC. It's going to be really exciting to see what Clay Helton's going to be able to do. He did just get that new contract extension, and like we said on National Signing Day, Tom, I don't think that them getting all those recruits a day after that he got that contract extension was any surprise at all. They see USC plus young quarterback plus stability equal success.
Does this make USC the favorite in 2018 in the Pac-12?
I'm still going with Washington.
Agreed.
I don't think it's fair to peg, even if they start to JT Daniels or somebody else, USC is the favorite right now. I'm still going with the Huskies.
He should still play. He's technically a senior in high school.
Yes.
It's going to be tough to make that big of a jump and win the Pac-12.
All right, let's break into the top three now. And coming in at number three, we have the Longhorns. They had the best class in the Big 12. 27 players committed overall. They have the breadth and depth.
I love this class. This might be, I know like the Georgia class is maybe the best ever and the Ohio State class is incredible. This Texas class might be my favorite just because it was so incredible what they were able to do in the state of Texas. They completely dominated unlike anything we've seen out of this school in a long time. They totally dominated, and also that defense is going to be absolutely fierce. These are the secondary guys that they were able to get from the state of Texas alone. Caden Stearns from Sabalo, Texas. B.J. Foster from Angleton, Texas. They were able to get Anthony Cook from Houston, Texas. They were able to get Jalen Green, also from Houston, Texas. Deshaun Jameson, also from Houston, Texas. All those guys are strictly in the secondary. Their defense is going to be awesome. I can't wait to see how these guys grow up. I think Tom Herman is really trying to grow a – just dominate the state of Texas. Like, honestly, the Longhorns should be able to do. This class has a lot of depth to it. 27 overall players is a crazy amount for one class. I can't wait to see what this Texas class turns into. This might end up having the most potential of any class inside of a conference, because if they make the defense that they're hoping to make, they could dominate the Big 12 or Big 10.
You mentioned some of those secondary guys. Let's start with one in B.J. Foster. Now, for the longest time, he was actually the number one safety in the nation, and then he ended up getting jumped by a guy we'll discuss here in just a moment. But with B.J. Foster, I think he is a guy that could be a very early impact player for this Texas football team. I think he has the ability. I think he's a little bit more maybe pro-ready than a guy like a Caden Stearns. I think Foster's ready to go early. I am excited to see what Foster can bring. Texas is replacing a lot of guys in their secondary. I think guys like Foster can make an impact early. I also think a guy like Caden Stearns can also make that impact. Before the services updated their recruits for the last time, it was actually Foster who was number 19 overall and the number one safety. That changed. It's now Caden Stearns, a five-star recruit, number 19 overall, and the number one safety. And Stearns and Foster in general epitomize what this Texas class was. Their top nine recruits play defensive back or wide receiver. Ha. They focused heavily on those two areas. Now, they closed well with some other offensive linemen and defensive linemen down the stretch, but this is a secondary and receiver-focused class. I think guys like Stearns and Foster, you could see play very early in their careers.
Also adding on to the fact that they have two decent quarterbacks coming in with Sam Ellinger, and then obviously we'll see what happens with Shane Bichelle going forward, but the guy to look out for going forward, Cameron Rising, the pro quarterback that they brought in, the number 11 quarterback in the country, number 247. A little bit low, but at the same time, can never have too much quarterback depth. And I think that if Ellinger isn't the option, I'm not a big fan of Bichelle. I think that he could come in, maybe make an impact. Probably not this year, maybe the year after that.
All right, Texas, number one school in the Big 12. Let's kick it to the number one school in the Big 10, and that was the Ohio State Buckeyes. They got a lot of huge pickups on National Signing Day, I think, but the most obvious one was Nicholas Petit-Ferrer.
And I think in general with Ohio State, and we'll get to the number one team, I think you guys know that it's Georgia here, that was a back-and-forth battle throughout. And Ohio State moved up when they got Nick, and they dropped back down, and it was a very much a back-and-forth battle throughout. We'll start with the offensive lineman. That was a huge get for Ohio State. A lot of people thought he was actually going to go to Florida. In the end, he decides to not. He goes to Ohio State. We'll see if he plays right away. I don't know if he actually end up willing, but this is a massive get for the Buckeyes, Harris. And oh, by the way, doesn't count in their top 100, top 300, but they also got the top JUCO player in defensive tackle, Antoine Jackson. We'll discuss here in a moment. But what do you think of the big offensive lineman, Nicholas Petit-Ferrer?
I think he's going to be in a cornerstone of their offense for many, many years to come. While I do like the offensive tackle, I think the rest of the class is just as ridiculous because we don't really talk about it that much. You don't really hear a lot of big names. I got one for you. How about Tyreek Johnson, the number one or the number two safety in the entire country? Absolute monster, 6'1", 200 pounds. How about Tommy Tagai, the defensive tackle, number 55 in the country, third defensive tackle in the country? Oh, yeah, also Teron Vincent, the number one D tackle in the nation. This isn't just, oh, they have an offensive lineman here and there. This is a really good, really deep, really powerful class. 20 four-star recruits. 20. That is absolutely outrageous. This class going forward, you're going to hear a lot of these names, and we're all going to look back one day and be like, oh my God, they all came from the same recruiting class? That's what this Ohio State class is. I think that we're not talking enough about some of the names on this list.
In many, many years, this is actually the best class in the nation, but it wasn't this year because it was a back and forth between the number one team.
Speaking
of that.
That's
the Georgia Bulldogs. They were the number one team overall, number one in the SEC, and I think if there's one word to describe this class, it's stacked.
Stacked. Wow. Goodness.
How?
Holy beef. Incredible. One of the best college classes, recruiting classes that we have ever seen. Justin Fields, Zamir White, Cade Mays as well. So many guys. Seven total five-star recruits, Brenton Cox, to throw in another name. How about Adam Anderson? Tyson Campbell, the guy that got on National Signing Day, Patrick Surtain Jr.'s buddy. You know that they wanted to play against each other in the SEC. Mm-hmm. Look, this entire class is ridiculous. I hope they all live up to their potential. I hope that Justin Fields comes out and dominates the SEC. I hope that Zamir White becomes everything that he can be and replace, you know, Sonny Mikkel and Nick Chubb. I hope that this Georgia class completely lives up to everything that it should and is supposed to be, because if it is, Georgia is going to absolutely dominate college football for the next 2 to 3 years, maybe specifically with this class. That is only if they live up to their potential, and it starts with Justin Fields, because if Justin Fields can end up being the superstar that they think that he can be, they're going to be unstoppable on offense.
And they already have Jake Fromm, and they still found a way to get a guy like Justin. I think it's a testament to how good of a job Kirby Smart did this year. If you're Justin Fields, you could have gone literally to any program in the nation and said, hey, I want to be a starter. Can you make me a day one starter? And a lot of those programs would have said, yeah, we need you. Come on down. Sure, like whatever you want. But he stays and goes to Georgia. Stays in state. Was committed to Penn State. Was a flip there. What could have been for Penn State, probably, had they kept Justin Fields. And Jacob Eason leaves. Jake Fromm stays. Fields could be your day one backup for Georgia. How many teams can say, yeah, we have the number two overall recruit as our backup quarterback?
Clemson has a five-star. But
Clemson can say it, too. That's about it.
I think what's incredible, though, about Justin Fields, and especially going to next year, he's such a good athlete. I think in terms of his overall arm, we'll see it improve as he gets better and better in college, but we're going to see him put his athleticism on screen next year for Georgia. They're going to have Justin Fields packages. You better bet he's going to be involved in the offense next year. He's not just going to sit on the sideline. They better involve him. He's one of the best athletes we've had come out at quarterback in a long time.
Not a bad idea. I wouldn't be opposed to redshirting him, though, and getting that extra year in theory of eligibility.
Imagine next year, you know, if they don't redshirt him, you could have Justin Fields, Zamir White, along with DeAndre Swift on the field at the same time. That
like
is
speed?
The fastest offense in the SEC. Are you kidding me? You could do like a triple lateral and end up 80 yards down the field before the defense even knows where the ball is going. I think this could be a great, great class.
Before we get to our winners and losers, gentlemen, who had a better class? Tom,
I mean, I don't want to discount what Ohio State did, but it's Georgia. They had 7 5-star recruits. What the Bulldogs did was absolutely incredible. Yeah, not as many 4-stars, but their quality was better than Ohio State's, and their volume was just as good.
Their class was so good, we're not even talking about the fact that they stole Michigan's top-ranked prospect and also stole a 4-star prospect from Alabama. We didn't even mention them until the very end of talking. That's how good this class was. It's insane.
All right, guys, before we wrap things up, let's go ahead and take a look at our winners and losers from National Signing Day. And we'll start with the winners. We have USC, Nebraska, Georgia, Texas, and Ohio State. And obviously, it's easy to say that Georgia is the biggest winner. But outside of Georgia, Tom, who really won that?
I mean, I think it is fair to mention Georgia because of how just great their class was.
Yes.
Same with Ohio State. Look, Georgia has 4 4-star better offensive linemen and 4 top 150 linebackers. That's a good way to kind of build a program. We've mentioned Ohio State. I also want to mention this on Texas as well. This does not count, but 3-star linebacker Luke Brockermeyer walked on to Texas over offers from schools like Rice and Oregon State. Mm-hmm. That's when you know you did something right, when you're getting guys to walk on. And you mentioned their dominance in the state of Texas, Harris. Of the top 15 recruits from the state of Texas,
lay it on me, Tom.
11 of them went to Texas.
Wow.
That's how you do things in the state of Texas. Tom Herman has Texas back in the right way, at least when it comes to the recruiting world. And Nebraska with Scott Frost, the way they finished, incredible. They're outside of USC. I think Nebraska was maybe the biggest riser in the pre-draft or in the pre-signing period.
All right, a lot of winners to talk about, but let's talk about the losers. Big names on this program are on this list, guys. Bama, Michigan, Wisconsin, who was a powerhouse last year, didn't even finish in the top 25. Also Arkansas and Texas Tech. But who's the biggest loser?
It's Michigan. It has to be Michigan. There's no maybe Texas Tech because their class was just so unbelievably horrible. But I'm sorry. With all the expectations surrounding Jim Harbaugh, all the expectations around this program, for them to come into number one and then on National Signing Day to lose the guy who's been committed to them since 2 Junes ago, unacceptable. I think that this Michigan class is a huge, huge disappointment. I find it funny we have Alabama as a loser on this list, but I guess when you drop from being number one for 7 straight years and you go to 7, the chink in the armor makes you a loser. But I didn't expect Wisconsin to have a great recruiting class. I didn't really expect Arkansas to have a great recruiting class. Michigan, though, the expectation was there.
I get what you're saying. Wisconsin finishes 44th. That's not very good at all as far as I'm concerned. Arkansas was 49th with just 17 guys. So small class, but not the best
coaching
start.
Change, it's bad
still
couple
not
of years.
The best start. But Texas Tech, 73rd in the nation. They're behind schools like Oregon State and Kansas in terms of Power 5. But in terms of Group of 5, Houston beats them. Central Florida beats them. Tulane beat them. South Florida beat them. Boise State. And oh, by the way, FIU beat Texas Tech this year.
Hey, the national champion UCF Golden Knights should definitely beat Trump and Texas Tech, just saying.
All right, those were the winners and losers of the 2018 recruiting class. And if you missed the top 25, don't worry. We're about to loop everything and break it all down for you guys. But for Tom Downey and Harris Rubenstein, I'm Lena Bond, and we'll see you next time.